Yes, as we're going to finish Revelation 19. The notes that y'all got from last week, we'll go over those as well. And we have some extras over there. Revelation 19 deals with the final battle of Armageddon. And what we're looking at is everything that has led up to this battle of Armageddon. This just didn't start during the tribulation. This just didn't start in the book of Revelation. This has been ongoing since beginning of time in Genesis. And it really all started when Lucifer was kicked out of heaven by God for his sin of pride and arrogance and mutiny against God. Ever since that time that Lucifer has been kicked out of heaven, he was given a name called Satan, the deceiver, the devil. And ever since he has been on this planet, he has been in the process of trying to lead people or gather as many souls to hell as he possibly can because his time is short. So ever since that moment where Satan was kicked out of heaven, now a lot of people say, when did that exactly happen? This happened probably right before the creation of the heavens and the earth, or soon after it happened. The timeline is not real precise, but the mutiny, everything that happened was shortly after the creation of the heavens and the earth. Lucifer, which means light, has a unique power within himself that God put in him. If you have been studying in the last few weeks, he uses these powers that has been given to him, and unfortunately he's using it for evil, for bad now, to lure people away from God. And what we're looking at, many people will consider conspiracy theories and what have you. It's hard to call something a theory when you have evidence and proof for it. And what we try to propagate and what we try to show here is not theory. I'm not a conspiracy theorist at all. I've gotten in trouble more times for just saying the truth than going along with the crowd and playing along with the mainstream media or mainstream public and say, well, according to popular opinion, we believe this, this, and this. I'm not going to do that. But what we're going to show you in the Bible, if you listen and study, the Word of God will tell us of the warnings of that what is happening. He will give us biblical examples of what is happening. I think the one thing that has really given me hope is that people are beginning to wake up to what the devil is doing. The people are finally beginning to wake up to what he's trying to do with our children, what he's doing in our justice system, political system, education system, and so on. Unfortunately, I think we woke up too late. Damage has been done. People have been hurt. People have been lost. He has gotten his agenda across what he has wanted to do. But what we're going to do is show you, and to hopefully others that will see this for our younger generations will understand why it is so important, why we need to know this. And the reasons are in back of us. Romans chapter 13, verse 14. I'm going to read that to you. And I want to be like a lawyer, and I'm going to prove my case using God's word and examples of why we need to know this. And actually, it's a commandment in the Bible that we have to know this. It's actually a biblical commandment. It says here, Romans chapter 13, verse 12. Romans chapter 13, verse 12 says that the night is far spent, the day is at hand. Now, what he meant by the day is at hand, that means the day of the Lord. The night is far spent. It's talking about the time period when the Lord's day is upon us. When the scripture says the night is far spent, that means that we are just about at the end of time when the day of the Lord is coming, when it will be upon us. Let us therefore cast off the works of darkness. That is a commandment. When it says to let us cast off, that literally means to put away, never to be seen again. To bury. It actually means to bury something. When you bury something, it is totally out of sight. So when you read in your Bible, let us therefore cast off, what the Bible is really saying is let us bury and get rid of permanently the works of darkness. And let us put on the armor of light, which is the armor of God, as we find in Ephesians chapter 6. Now it says here in verse 14, but put on the Lord Jesus Christ and make not provision for the flesh to fulfill the lust thereof. Which is basically going back to verse 12 saying cast off the works of darkness. So that is a commandment to every individual right there in this scripture. Each one of us that is a believer in Jesus Christ is commanded to cast off the works of darkness and to put on the armor of light. That's a commandment from God. Now I'm going to go to Ephesians. And in Ephesians 5, verses 8 and 11, it says this. Ephesians 5, verses 8 and 11. For you are sometimes darkness. Now this is the point that I want to emphasize. You are sometimes in darkness. What does that mean? Before we became a believer in Jesus Christ, before we were born again, we were like those people in darkness. We had no vision. We had no idea where we were going. We had no idea what was right or wrong. According to God's standard, we were sometimes darkness, but now you are the light in the Lord. Now you are in the light of the Lord. Walk, live as children of the light. That's talking about the light of the Lord Jesus Christ. We were sometimes in darkness, but we are now of the light of the Lord. Don't you remember those people before you were saved, before you were born again? Do you remember people in your life that prayed for you? Do you remember people that witnessed to you about Jesus? I remember that very clearly. Those prayers and the witness of people actually led you to Jesus Christ. Now, verse 11 says this. This is the verse that I really want you to focus on. It's this verse right here, Ephesians 5:11. Have no fellowship with the unfruitful works of darkness. In other words, have no relationship, have no connection. Have nothing in common with the unfruitful works of darkness. But rather reprove them, rather reveal them, expose them. Now he was writing to the church in Ephesus in 64 AD. We see here in Romans 12, 13. That's right. Oh, 13, 12. Romans 13, 12. He's commanded us individually. Each one of us individually cast off the works of darkness. Here in Ephesians 5, 11, he's talking to the church. And he's actually commanding the church to do two things. Number one, in verse 11, have no fellowship or don't have any relationship with the unfruitful works of darkness. That's what he's commanding the church. Now, people are saying, well, what are the unfruitful works of darkness? What is that? We're a church. We don't deal with that. We're going to find out this evening if churches are or not. We're going to expose that. Which leads to the second point, but rather reveal them, expose them, show them. In other words, bring to that which is hidden in secret. The devil has infiltrated everything upon us as we know it. He has infiltrated our money, our government, even churches. He's infiltrated anything, our education system with our children. If you go to Fox News, go under local events, national events. Look at what is happening in our schools today. There are three things in Fox News that came out. Two of them involve sex education, one starting as early as second grade. Now, I don't know about you, second graders have no business learning about sex education in school. And ironically, this is all happening in the Northeast and in the West Coast. Again, when you allow the devil to come in and utilize, especially our children, California, New York, Washington. I'll tell you what, in Washington, what was it? Colorado, Washington, pot is now legal. The devil is now having his way with the druggies in those states. California is broke. They're actually charging, taxing everything on the spot. Food, water, air. They want to tax air in California. How do you tax air in California? But again, that's California for you, okay? Thank God we don't live there. But this goes back to the time of having no fellowship with the unfruitful works of darkness. God commands us very clearly and distinctly that we have no connection with anything of the devil. We're going to show you this evening some of those things that are happening. The one world religion, occultic symbols that are found in your money, that are found in Social Security, that are found, did you know that some of our government buildings in these United States of America are actually pattern after certain diagrams of occultism. I'm going to show you that this evening on that computer. You could go to your Christwatch.com. I'm going to write it up there. Go to Christwatch.com. It'll show reveal everything to you. Here's the thing. Everything that has started in Genesis has built to this point of Revelation. All the evil, all the satanic things, everything that is happening is now building up to Revelation 19. This just didn't happen in the last few months or years. This has been going on since the beginning of time. Evil has always had an agenda to usurp and undermine the authority of God. And if we do not get a handle on this, it's going to destroy us eventually. And if you remember in Revelation, in the beginning of Revelation, in chapters 2 and 3, Jesus himself was the judge. He was the critique of all the churches during that time. Six out of those seven churches were found in fault for something. And the one that was being faithful was the smallest of the seven churches. That church, the Church of Philadelphia, was the most persecuted, the most hated, not only by the Roman Empire, but by the world itself, because they stood for truth. But if you remember this, in the Revelations chapters 2 and 3, six out of these seven churches suffered because they did the things of the world. They did not cast off the unfruitful works of darkness. Ephesus, the first church, they lost their love for the Lord. They loved the world more than the Lord, and they got entangled with the things of the world. The church in Smyrna. This church was caught. Now listen to this. I know thy works in tribulation and poverty, and thou art rich, but I have known the blasphemy of them which they say are Jews, and are not, but the synagogue of Satan. Here was Jesus telling this church in Smyrna that because of their worldliness, they were not known as a church of the Jews anymore. They were known as the synagogue of Satan. Now, why is that important to understand? The synagogue of Satan is an actual organization that is bent on two things. Their agenda is a one-world government and a one-world religion. Well, I never heard of that. It is true. And it's steeped in globalism. It is steeped in the Luciferian philosophy. Wiccans, witchcraft, Satanists, atheist, communist, socialist, all believe in this Luciferian ideology. What does that mean? The denial of God, the denial of the devil, the denial of heaven and hell. If you get people to deny the devil, if you get people to deny hell, and if you actually convince people that those things don't exist, it actually makes it easier for the devil to come in and sway them away. And it says here in verse 10, fear none of those things, Revelation 2:10, fear none of those things which thou shalt suffer. Behold, the devil shall cast some of you into prison that ye may be tried. Now here, Jesus was warning this church, Smyrna, in Revelation chapter 2. He said this, behold, the devil himself shall cast some of you into prison that ye may be tried, and ye shall have tribulation 10 days. That represents a cycle, a time period. Now, if Jesus said this in Revelation chapter 2, that the devil himself is going to throw Christians into prison, what is happening today in the year 2014? Don't you think that's happening now? Yes. The devil is throwing people into prison simply for praying, naming the name of Jesus, for witnessing for Jesus. We have pastors, especially in the Middle East, that go on missionary trips. They're being thrown into prison. We have this one pastor, I think in Russia, they're trying to get out of this, come out on TBN News. The devil is in the business of trying to squelch and deny God's authority and power through the gospel. He's in the business of trying to get rid of all these things. So when you look here in the scriptures, I'm just telling you this to show you the pattern that is happening now. The pattern of unfruitful works of darkness, the pattern of those things that get in the way of actually bringing to light those things that reveal what the true agenda is. Now, the true agenda stems in this.
And the true agenda stems in this. Three things we're going to look at this evening. The first thing is this. We're going to look at the deceitment. The deceit of works. The word works does not necessarily mean things that are tangible. It's a system. We're going to look at that this evening. That's the first thing we're going to look at. The devil has a way of deceiving people through a system. We're going to reveal what that system is. Number two, occultism. Occultism is the study and the belief in the occult, or, for lack of a better word, demonism. Now, a lot of people are saying, why are we studying demonism? Why do we need to know about the devil? I think we love God and we love Jesus. Yes, we do. But I just read to you those verses right here. It is our duty and our job to expose what the devil is doing. The devil is not going to tell you what he's going to do. He's just going to do it. The third thing that we're going to show you, the system of works, the deceitment, the occultism, which is commonly known as demonism, we're going to show you the agenda. The agenda of Satan, who will disguise himself as the light. There is an agenda of Satan that has started before the beginning of time, and he uses certain symbols that we alluded to in the past few weeks. God's will, these are very important verses to understand. These will tell you what we're talking about. But these two verses up here, I left those up there to show you the connection between the first one, the second one, and the third part of this. These are things. Now, a lot of people say, well, why do we need to know this? Here's why. If you are associated with any of these things, or if you unknowingly become entrapped in any of these things, you have to get out of it, because the devil is one that he won't take into consideration if you know it or not, or the lack of ignorance of it. But he will take into account that you actually are doing it. If you don't get away, you could become entrapped. The agenda of Satan has been going on since Genesis. He has always wanted to become the light. But he's not the light, as we have said. Only the Lord Jesus Christ is the light of the world. The system has been in place for a long time. We can't get rid of it, but we can know what to look for. And those are the things we're going to look at this evening. Let's look here. And I'm going to write some things on the board. Let's look here first, some of the things that we've been talking about. Revelation chapter 19, I'm going to emphasize some things here that we need to get into. First of all, in Revelation 19, verse 19, it says, "The beast, the kings of the earth, and their armies gathered together to make war against him that sat on the horse and against his army." Here's what we want to bring out. The beast, the Antichrist, and the kings of the earth, and their armies. All the armies will come together and be united into a global army. That is happening as we speak right now. The United States of America will lose their sovereignty and hand over the armed forces to this global government. Now you're probably saying, wait a minute, being Memorial Day, and we do want to honor our veterans that have served this country, those that have fought and died for this country, amen? This is the country that they defend. But then in the future, there will no longer be a United States armed force. It will become a global force. That will happen even before the Antichrist takes power. Will this happen in our lifetime? Yes, it will. It will happen in our lifetime. The global economy, the global system, one world government will push and force a one world army. Now, the kings of the earth and their armies are talking about the 10 major armies that are be gathered under the rule of the Antichrist. the United States and North America will be part of that. They will be gathered together to make war against him that sat on the horse. And who is that? The Lord Jesus Christ. And against his army. We want to make this very clear. When it says against his army, we're talking about God's angelic and saintly army that will accompany him when he comes back. People are going to say, wait a minute. Whoa. Where does that say that? I mean, do you mean God has an army? Yes, the Lord Jesus Christ has an army. Let me tell you what the army is made up of. It's in two parts here. The first part in God's army is found in 1 Thessalonians 3:13. The first part of his army includes saints. Who are the saints? The saints are the chosen ones of God, those that are born again and believe in the Lord Jesus Christ. Let me read that to you. In 1 Thessalonians 3:13, the scripture says, and it says here, to you, that he may establish your hearts in holiness even before our Father, at the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ with all his saints. With all his saints. That means that the Lord Jesus Christ is coming back with all his saints. This is part of the army of God. We're going to witness this. The second part is found in the book of Jude. Let me get that for you. In Jude, verses 14 and 15. If I'm going too fast, let me know. I'm just trying to go at a pace where we have a lot to cover. Part of God's army includes angels. Now we need to make this very clear. God has an army of angels that are used solely for fighting. There is an army corps of angels that are used solely for fighting against demons. We see this here in the book of Jude, verses 14 and 15. Now notice here. And Enoch also prophesied, the seventh from Adam, prophesied of these, saying, behold, the Lord cometh with 10,000 of his what? His saints. Again, we see the part of this here of saints. And to execute judgment upon all, and to convince all that are ungodly, among all that are of their ungodly deeds, which they have ungodly committed, and all their hard speeches, which ungodly sinners have spoken evil against him. Ungodly is used four times in verse 15. To convince all the ungodly of their ungodly deeds, those that have ungodly committed sins, and against ungodly sinners. Four times it is used in that one verse alone. Enoch prophesied about this in Genesis chapter 5, verse 18. Enoch saw this in Revelation back in Genesis. Amazing, isn't it? Enoch is one of the two witnesses, along with Elijah in Revelation, that will come and witness to the world for a short period of time of their sins. How in the world did Enoch see the future in Genesis? Because God chose him, because of his close walk with God. Enoch walked closely with God and was one of only two men raptured into heaven. Can anyone name those two men? I just said it. Enoch and Elijah. Those are the two men that will come back and be witnesses, the two witnesses in Revelation. Why those two men? Because they never tasted death. They did not die physically. Okay? And if you look in the scriptures, especially Ecclesiastes, a natural man cannot die more than twice, I believe it says in the scriptures. They haven't even died once. Enoch, it says here, Enoch from the seventh of Adam prophesied of these, saying, behold, the Lord cometh down with 10,000 of his saints. In Zechariah 14, 3 through 5. Talks about how the angels of God, along with the saints, will actually battle. They will actually do the battle, and they will fight in that battle. Who will be among the angels that will fight in that battle? Michael the archangel. It says here in the book of Daniel, how Daniel will lead that army as well. He will lead the army, and he is the one that will actually get the Antichrist, get his body. And he will be the one that God has assigned to throw the Antichrist into the lake of fire. That's amazing, isn't it? We're going to witness that, and we're going to see that by God's grace. We're going to see the actual throwing of the Antichrist and the throwing of Lucifer, the devil, into the lake of fire forever. We're going to witness that with our own eyes. Now, here are some of the things that we need to be careful of in verse 20, as I go back to Revelation 19:20. And the beast was taken, and with him the false prophet. Now, who wrought miracles before him, which have deceived them that have received the mark of the beast, and them that worship the image. The mark of the beast we're going to study in the coming weeks. We're going to show you what the mark is going to look like in a way that has been shown in the past. The Roman emperors actually had a symbol of their name that was actually either branded or tattooed on the citizens of Rome to show that they belong to the Caesar. They had no choice in it. They had to do it. Especially the slaves, those that served in the armies. They were branded like cattle to show that they belong to Caesar. That same concept the Antichrist is going to use when he will force those that are left behind to receive the mark of the beast, a chip that will be implanted in their right hand or in their forehead. If they don't do this, they will be beheaded. Their heads will be cut off. How do we know this? Revelation chapter 20 verse 4 says this. Revelation chapter 20 verse 4 is probably the one verse that tells us of the martyrdom . This would probably be the greatest example of the greatest number of martyrs at one time in history that we're going to see in the tribulation. More people are going to die for the cause of Christ when the Antichrist takes over than at any time in human history. And it says here in Revelation chapter 20, verse 4, and I saw thrones and they that sat upon them, and judgment was given unto them, and I saw the souls of them, listen to this, I saw the souls of them that were beheaded for the witness of Jesus and for the word of God, which had not worshipped the beast, neither his image, neither received his mark upon their foreheads or in their hands. And they lived and reigned with Christ 1,000 years. Let me read that again in verse 4. And I saw the souls of them that were beheaded for the witness of Jesus and for the word of God, which had not worshipped the beast, neither received his image or received his mark upon their foreheads or in their right hand. This scripture makes it very clear that they were martyred. They were how? Martyred by being beheaded for the cause of Jesus Christ. Here is a trick question. I wish I had more yogurt cards to give you. Y'all got this down? There is a nation that still practices beheading as a capital punishment. There is still a region in the world that practices beheading today as part of capital punishment, as their capital punishment. As a matter of fact, if you steal something, the hand that did the actual stealing, they will cut it off. If you saw something that you were not supposed to see, they will actually pluck that eye out. They still believe in that capital punishment. And they use it as part of their religion to purify, sinners. Do you believe that? Let me repeat that again. They use this as part of their religion to so-called purify sinners by cutting on hands, feet, eyes, whatever it takes for them when they have committed a sin. You talk about, is that pretty barbaric to you? Don't you thank God that our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ doesn't do that with us? If we still, he doesn't cut our hand off, huh? If we go someplace where we shouldn't have gone, he doesn't cut our feet off or anything like that. But this one region and this one religion does that, and part of it is beheading. Do you know what their religion is? Islam. Thank you. Middle East. The Islamic religion in the Quran that they really behold and upheld. In the Quran, their book, the actual sinners that betray Islam, the actual sinners that go against Islam are to be beheaded. That is their punishment. They will be beheaded. That practice is still alive today in Islam. They behead women, they behead men, they even behead children. All those that go against Allah, that go against the teachings of Muhammad, they will be beheaded and are still being beheaded today. Why is that relevant? Why is that significant? Because the Antichrist is going to what? Those that do not receive the mark of the beast will be what? Beheaded. Why is the Antichrist into beheading? Because he is from the Islamic religion and he's from the Middle East. It makes sense and it comes together. It has said that in Zechariah, in the book of Daniel, that the Antichrist will come from the Middle East. He will come from the rejected tribe of Esau. He will be from the Edomites that came from Edom. He is from that rejected line, opposite of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. He will be part Jew, and that's why the nation of Israel is going to make a pact with Antichrist, because he is part Jew by blood. But he's from the line of Esau, and Esau was the rejected line. God had nothing for Esau. He was never part of the plan. As a matter of fact, his mother was what? Hagar. Was Hagar chosen to bear the covenant child? No, that was Sarah. So if you look at all this and you put it all together, you get an idea of why things are the way they are. So in Revelation chapter 20, we see that those saints will be beheaded. Now it's time for a Kodak moment. It's time for a reality check. Do you believe what had just been said? Do you believe it? Do you believe without a shadow of a doubt what has been taught and said? You should believe it because I read it to you. You should believe it because I just read it to you from God's word, what's going to happen. There is no excuse out there for those that are watching. There is no excuse to live in ignorance anymore. You have been shown the truth. You have been shown by scriptures. You have been shown by facts. You have been shown by points on the board. I am proving to you my case that this is the truth. There is nothing hidden. Everything is going to be exposed. Well, I don't believe it. That's your loss. That's at your peril. If you want to believe a lie, remember this. If you are left behind after the rapture, you're going to have to make a choice. Do I receive the mark of the beast, or do I die for Jesus Christ? That is your choice. If you die for Jesus Christ, you will live and reign with Christ for 1,000 years. If you receive the mark of the beast, I refer to you to Revelation chapter 19, verses 20 and 21. You will burn in the lake of fire with the Antichrist and the false prophet. That's what's going to happen. Now, I'm not making this up. This is not my opinion. This is something that I'm reading to you straight out of the Bible. This brings to mind an instance that happened, and this is getting old. It's found in 1 Corinthians. I'm going to read something to you that I'm going to defend a fellow Christian this evening. And here's how I'm going to defend this fellow Christian. He got in trouble, and it came out in the news this week, if you've been watching the news. He got in trouble because he went to his neighborhood church and he read this scripture. He was actually given a testimony, kind of like a sermon at this church in Louisiana. And he read this one verse. And these are the verses that he read. And I'm going to read them as well. All he did was read these verses. And he was called a homophobe. He was called one that did not hold mankind in honor. He was put down because he was anti-gay. He was put down because he was not social. He was not conforming to the ways of modern religion. And I'm going to read to you what he read. 1 Corinthians 6:9. In 1 Corinthians 6:9 it says this: Know ye not that the unrighteous shall not inherit the kingdom of God?